Tonight, if you haven't guessed, today I'm going to be talking about the Lion King. For those who haven't been here for a while, we've been in a series of messages that I'm closing out today that I titled The Gospel According to Disney, where we've been looking at a number of the most popular Disney movies and looking at some of the messages that are conveyed through those films and then measuring them against the Word of God and seeing whether or not they align. Now, so far I've talked about, I started with Pinocchio and the difference between always letting your conscience be your guide or the Holy Spirit being your guide. What's the difference? Talked about that. Beauty and the Beast, we looked at how you shouldn't judge people by outward appearances. Then last week I talked about Dumbo and his little magic feather, which I used as a way to talk about idols and how we often put our faith in things that really have no power in and of themselves and how we should really be looking to God for those things. And today, I'm going to be talking about the Lion King. And this is the gist of the message. Now, for those of you who haven't seen the Lion King, I'm going to give you a very brief synopsis of the movie. It's essentially about a kingdom that is ruled by a good king by the name of Mufasa, who has a son named Simba. And Mufasa is this really good and loving father who teaches Simba what it means to be a wise and responsible king, since he knows one day little Simba is going to grow up and inherit the kingdom. Now, in any story, of course, there's always an antagonist, and in this case, it's Mufasa's brother Scar, who thinks that he should be king. And so he comes up with this very evil and sadistic plan to try and kill Mufasa and put the blame on the little lion prince, Simba. And he does that. And he does that by triggering a stampede of wildebeest, and he puts Simba in harm's way, knowing full well that his loving and protective father will run down and save him. Which Scar was right, because that is exactly what Mufasa did. At the last minute, he springs to action and saves his boy, but he puts himself in danger and finds himself right there in the path of these wildebeest. And so when trying to escape from them, he clings to this cliff, scaling that the side of it until he reaches the top where he sees his brother Scar. Thinking that his brother would help him, Scar takes that opportunity to take his brother's life. He tosses him off the cliff into that stampede where, unfortunately, Mufasa is killed. And Scar takes advantage of the situation. What he does is he convinces young Simba that it's all his fault, and even his own mother wouldn't forgive him for what it is that he's done. And unfortunately, Simba falls for the lie, and he's overwhelmed with guilt and shame and fear, and he runs off, like Scar tells him to, run away. Now, it's this next part of the movie that served as the catalyst for this message that I'm going to be sharing with you this morning. See, if you've watched the movie, you know that at this point, it takes a lighthearted turn where when Simba meets two friends, Timon and Pumbaa. And they tell him to leave his past behind. And they try to convince him to join them in living a life without any care or concern. Their motto is Hakuna Matata, which means no worries. And it's this problem-free philosophy of life where they have no responsibilities, not a care in the world. And they convince Simba, who really at this point should be taking up his rightful place as the king of Pride Rock, they convince him to accept a life of irresponsibility and mediocrity. And instead of eating antelopes and running and hunting, and he's sitting there eating insects and grubs with Timon and Pumbaa. And even worse than that, instead of defending his father's kingdom against a cruel enemy, Scar, who takes it over, instead of defending this kingdom, he's content to hang around with his buddies, pretty much doing nothing all day. And slowly, he begins to forget who he is. And it's this theme of Simba making the very poor, very immature decision to neglect the responsibilities that come with being the son of a king that I want to talk about for just a bit here, because I believe there's a powerful spiritual lesson in this for all of us. So in the Old and New Testament, Jesus, the Messiah, is described as being a king. For those of you who have been Christians for any length of time, I don't have to tell you that. You know, he was called the King of the Jews. Even Pontius Pilate at Jesus at his trial was, hey, are you a king or what? So he was known as a king. When he was first announced, Gabriel came down when he was announced to be, when she was, he was announcing to her that she was going to give birth to this Messiah. Gabriel the angel said this: he will be great, and he will be called the Son of the Most High, and the Lord God will give to him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end. He was a king, and he was given all authority. That's what Jesus said. I've been given all authority in heaven and in earth. And the Apostle Paul affirms this truth in the book of Ephesians. Listen to what the Apostle Paul says. He raised Jesus from the dead and seated him at his right hand in the heavenly realms. Right now, Jesus is presently seated on his throne at the right hand of God, far above all rule and authority and power and dominion, and above every name that is named, not only in this age, but in the one to come. That's why in the book of Revelation, it refers to Jesus as being the King of Kings, the boss of all bosses, above dominion and power and authorities. He's awesome. Now, I'm probably belaboring the point, but I'm intending to kind of do that because I really want to drive home this point. I want to make sure we understand the power and the majesty of our King Jesus and all that belongs to him, because who he is and all that he possesses as king directly impacts those of us who have placed our faith in him. Now, keeping in mind all the authority and the power and dominion and riches that of heaven that belong to Jesus, I want you to hear this scripture here. I want you to hear these words from the Apostle Paul to the church. Okay, listen to what he says. Since we are his true children, we qualify to share all his treasures. For indeed, which means you can bank on it, for indeed, we are heirs of God himself. And since we are joined to Christ, this is part I want you to really lay hold of. And since we are joined to Christ, we also inherit all that he is, all that he is, and all that he has. We will experience being co-glorified with him. That is a profound truth that, in my experience, I find few Christians have really taken the time to grasp, because that's heavy. But remember, again, think about it. Holy Spirit, help them grasp this truth. Jesus right now is presently seated at the right hand of God in heaven, above all power and authority. But look at what Ephesians chapter 2, verse 6 says. God raised us up with him and seated us with him in the heavenly realms. What the? So he's seated there next to God, and it says God also raised up with him, and we are also seated with him in the heavenly realms. That is mind-blowing. And what that means, if you can grasp this, is that if you are a true child of God, then you are, in fact, royalty. That is true. That's how we're described by the Apostle Peter. Listen to this. We are described as a royal priesthood. Some translations say a kingdom of priests who inherit all that King Jesus is and who inherit all that King Jesus has. It is awesome. And this is the thing. It's an amazing truth. You're royalty, and you possess authority and all the riches of heaven, but not to hoard selfishly for yourself. In fact, there's this interesting little quote in the new movie, the movie version of Lion King, where Simba's saying, "Dad, that's awesome. So we can take whatever we want." And Mufasa's like, "No, baby boy, a good king isn't after what he can take, but what he can give." It's a really beautiful quote. That's why the way that the Apostle Peter finishes this verse, if you go on, yeah, we're a royal priesthood. He also says we are God's instruments to do his work and speak out for him to tell others of the night and day difference that he's made for you from nothing to something and from rejected to accepted. But the reality, what I'm trying to lay on you here, is the reality that we are royal ambassadors of God's kingdom with the authority and power to act as his representatives here on this planet Earth. And that authority and power comes with responsibility. The responsibility of leading others out of the kingdom of darkness and into the kingdom of God's Son, who he loves. And that is the spiritual reality that we are living in as royal co-heirs of God's kingdom. That is the weight of glory and responsibility that we are supposed to be carrying with us every day. That's awesome. But here's the thing. With that said, so many Christians, with all that being true about them, have adopted this Hakuna Matata. What a wonderful phrase, philosophy of life, where they kind of just wander off settling for this second-rate life, this mediocrity, neglecting our royal responsibilities. Why? For a lot of reasons, because we're too afraid that to actually step into that calling would require us to change, or that it would, that stepping up against the enemy, which it does do this, stepping against the enemy puts us in the line of fire, puts us in danger. Yeah, well, that's pretty true. And people don't like the idea of that. Okay? So for a lot of reasons. But some of us have simply been lulled, for whatever reason, lulled into a life of complacency to the point that we've just kind of become okay with it. We've forgotten who we are, settled into that Hakuna Matata lifestyle, because then it means no worries. We bury our head in the sands or sit on our hands. And often we even try to drown out the sound of the Father calling us out of complacency by losing ourselves in all the distractions of this world. Comfortably numb, accepting mediocrity. It's interesting, as I was studying for this message, I always try to compare and contrast what the secular world says about stuff, how to overcome challenges of life, and then what the scriptures say. And so I was trying to look at, what does the secular world, what do they do when they find themselves bogged down in complacency? What is the advice that the pop psychologist would give? And as I was looking for stuff, it was funny because what I found were a lot of articles telling folks that being mediocre is good. There's a BBC News thing, how to be mediocre and be happy with yourself. Isn't that dumb? Or this. Now, this is a TED Talk by a really brilliant young man. I found there was a lot of good things he said, but this one. Average is awesome. Embracing mediocrity. That's how uninspiring. And now this. This is Mark Manson. He's a very popular blogger on personal development. He's always on TV for stuff. He wrote an article called In Defense of Being Average. It's a very interesting article. I would actually caution you. He says some really brilliant things, but he's also unnecessarily vulgar. I hate that stuff. When somebody's brilliant and then they throw in a cuss word, like, so that makes you cool or something, it actually shows you're dumb. But whatever. But what he's not saying in this article is that we should go and pursue mediocrity. And I'm not going to put words in his mouth or misrepresent what he's saying. He's not saying, so go and pursue mediocrity. But what he is saying is that if after having tried all these things and pursuing excellence, find that in the end you're mediocre, accept it. Okay, well, this is what he says. And listen to this. The vast majority of us will never be truly exceptional at anything. And that is okay. The ticket to emotional health, like physical health, comes from eating your veggies. That is, through accepting the bland and mundane truths of life. A light salad of, you're actually pretty average in the grand scheme of things. And some steamed broccoli of, the vast majority of your life will be mediocre. This will taste very bad at first, and you'll avoid eating it. But once ingested, your body will wake up feeling more potent and more alive. The knowledge and acceptance of your own mundane existence will actually free you to accomplish what you truly wish to accomplish with no judgments and no lofty expectations. You're both already blessed. Now, after hearing that, if you're like me, I read that, I found that, I didn't like it. Something in me almost felt offended, I guess, at his assessment of the average Joe. But the more I thought about it, the fact is, he's kind of right. How many extraordinary people beside me and Jacob Westfall over there do you really know? I kid, except for Jacob, you really are extraordinary, bro. But seriously, how many extraordinary people, like the Michael Jordans of life, do you really know? Odds are, not many. The reality is that most people choose the path of least resistance. They just do. We're prone to take easy street if possible. Most folks are, in fact, rather average. Okay, but here's the great news. God has always used average people like you and me to accomplish great, supernatural, life-changing things. Yeah, so maybe in the world's eyes, you're an average Jane or an average Joe. You're not the cutest. You're not the skinniest. You're not the prettiest. You're not the tallest. You're not the wealthiest person on the block or in your house. Okay, well, the reality is that as a child of God, you are anything but average. You are, in fact, royalty, empowered to do great things for God's kingdom. And in fact, we actually have a responsibility to use our God-given power and talent and authority to go out into the world and help rescue people from the clutches of the enemy. Man, we're really talking about matters of life and death here. And it seems that so many of God's people are unwilling to step into this battle that's raging around us all the time. This will sound mean, but we are a church, really, of probably 1,000 people who would call this church their home. When it's fall, we have about like 600 people who attend Old Town Church. 600 people, 1,000 people who attend church. And we can't have a children's ministry because we can't find people to do that. Well, that's really mean. I'm just saying that it's not just in here. It's out there. People aren't engaged. They're not walking in the giftings and the callings that God has bestowed upon them. Well, that's mean. Well, yeah. I feel that some of us desperately need to wake up and shake off that Hakuna Matata mentality and remember who we are, right? And remember the responsibility and the power that comes with being a child of the King. I want to show you a quick video here that shows the moment when young Prince Simba is awakened to the reality of who he is, okay? Check this out.
Creepy little monkey. Will you stop following me? Who are you?
The question is, who are you?
I thought I knew. Now I'm not so sure.
Well, I know who you are. Shh, come here. It's a secret.
Enough already. What is that supposed to mean, anyway?
It means you're a baboon. And I'm not.
I think you're a little confused.
Wrong. I'm not the one who's confused. You don't even know who you are.
Oh, and I suppose you know.
Sure do. You're Mufasa's boy. Bye.
Hey, wait! You knew my father?
Correction. I know your father.
I hate to tell you this, but he died a long time ago.
Nope! Wrong again! He's alive! And I'll show him to you. You follow old Rafiki, he knows the way. Come on! Don't dawdle! Hurry up!
Whoa, wait!
Thank you. Stop!
That's not my father. It's just my reflection.
No. Look hard. You see, he lives in you.
Simba, you have forgotten me.
No. How could I?
You have forgotten who you are, and so forgotten me. Look inside yourself, Simba. You are more than what you have become. You must take your place in the circle of life.
How can I go back? I'm not who I used to be.
Remember who you are. You are my son. And the one true king. Remember who you are.
No, please, don't leave me.
Remember.
Father.
Remember.
Don't leave me.
Remember.
It's an incredibly powerful scene. Particularly if you watch it and you listen to that with spiritual ears, there's so much in there that I wanted to bring out. But here's what I'm trying to get at. The enemy is using everything in his power and in this world to try and distract us from our calling and the truth of who we are. And all the while, God is calling out to us, our Father is calling out to us, trying to tell us that we need to rise above the distractions of this world and be the royal ambassadors that we're supposed to be. It wasn't until Simba remembered who he was and the power and the authority that he already possessed that gave him the courage to stand up against this evil Uncle Scar of his and take back what was rightfully his from the beginning. I see something very profound in that because, see, in the same way, we have an enemy like Scar who is asserting authority over us and others that he really doesn't have. So many folks are not stepping into stuff, as I said a little bit earlier, because they're fearful of, what does that mean if I step into this thing and I give up the comfort of, you know, the Hakuna Matata lifestyle of no worries? Well, here's what you need to know. The devil doesn't have any power over you. Look at this. Colossians chapter 2, verse 15. Jesus made a public spectacle of all the powers and principalities of darkness, stripping away from them every weapon and all of their spiritual authority and power to accuse us. And by the power of the cross, Jesus led them around as prisoners in a procession of triumph. He was not their prisoner. They were his. The only power the devil has over us is the power that we give to him. We need to remember who our king is. We need to remember the power and the authority that God has freely given to us. And we need to step into our responsibility as his ambassadors, as this royal priesthood that we are. And so the question is, why don't we? Why are so many Christians content to sit on the sidelines and let everybody else do stuff or let someone else go over there and do it? Why? Well, I think sometimes the simple fact is that people haven't been told this. So for some of you, this might be new. Like, what? We have that kind of power and authority? The devil doesn't have power over us? That, for some, is a new wrinkle in your brain. So you didn't know that. Well, now you know. But for others, I think the vast majority of others, it's not ignorance. We know what we should be doing. I believe the problem is many of us don't like accountability. We want to do what we want to do. We want to be king. We don't want Christ to be king. That's why when Nala tried to confront Simba about his complacency, what happened? He got offended. You don't know what you're talking about, and he wanders off. And when Rafiki, which is Swahili for friend, when Rafiki, that gorilla, whatever it is, monkey, chimp, yeah, baboon, when Rafiki tried to remind Simba about who he was, what happened? He got annoyed. Offended and annoyed because people are trying to challenge him to rise up. Okay, so here I am. I'm your Rafiki. Okay. Your friend, if you will. Trying to remind all of you that you have the potential to be infinitely more than the average Joe. We are children of the king. We have supernatural power and authority. We are royals. See, the question is whether or not you're acting like it or not. We read these words from the Apostle Paul, Philippians chapter 3, verses 17 through 21. Listen to what he's saying. There are many out there taking other paths, choosing other goals, trying to get you to go along with them, the Timon and Pumbas of this life, trying to say, man, forget all that noise, man. You have better things to do. You got to go make more money. You need that job. You need that lady or that guy in your life. There are many out there taking other paths, choosing other goals, trying to get you to go along with them. And I've warned you often, many times, sadly, now here I am having to do it again. See, all they want is easy street, the path of least resistance. They hate Christ's cross. What does he mean by that? I had to think about them. What do you mean? Hating Christ's cross. These are people who actually, it's not that they hate Christ and his cross. What they hate is the sacrificial nature of what it means to be a Christ follower, the picking up your cross and following. Well, I don't like that, man. I love my sins are forgiven and all the authority stuff. Oh, that sounds kind of cool. But pick up my cross and do something that requires self-sacrifice? Forget about it. That's what it means by the hate Christ's cross. See, but easy street is a dead-end street. Those who live there make their bellies their gods. Belches are their praise. All they can think of is their appetites. It reminds me of Pumbaa in the film. See, but listen to this. But there's far more to life for us. We're citizens of high heaven. We're waiting the arrival of the Savior, the Master, Jesus Christ, who will transform our earthly bodies into glorious bodies like his own. He'll make us beautiful and whole with the same powerful skill by which he is putting everything as it should be under and around him. Wow. Those are challenging words. And what I would ask is, does that offend you? But I should come to church once a month and I put a dollar in the bucket or whatever it is, the things that we justify ourselves and say, I am doing my part. Does it offend you? Because we really should examine our lives. Really, are we rising up to this high calling of making disciples and following Christ? Really, really. Let's not fool ourselves and convince ourselves, yeah, of course I am. We got to be honest with ourselves. I was just talking to my wife about this yesterday. I might not do certain things well. But one thing that I feel like I do pretty well is I'm very well aware of my faults and my flaws. Hyper aware to the point of I'm really hard on myself. Hyper aware of where I'm not measuring up. You know what? I'm okay. For now, I'm okay with that because it's good because it keeps me always mindful of, Rude, you are not walking in integrity in that area. Always. It's exhausting. Do you do that? Are you aware of your flaws? Really, and calling those things that are not lining up with what God's word says, are you calling them what they are? Sin. Saying, and then moving away from it. So are you offended by this? Are you annoyed? I hope not. If you're hearing this message with the gracious heart that I'm trying to convey it in, what are you going to do about this? Because this is real. What I'm telling you, this is not me. This is what the scriptures say. What Paul's saying is there's a greater reality than what we are worried about here in this carnal, earthly realm. He's talking about eternal things that matter, and we're out here messing about with stuff that really has no eternal value. He's trying to convey that to us. And so what are we going to do about it? Because it's a choice. Mufasa, on that little clip, he spoke down to his boy and said, look inside yourself, Simba. You're more than what you've become. Do you hear the father telling you that? It's like, baby boy, you're settling for this. You're more than that. Or to you, baby girl, princess is what you are really to the father. Princess, really? You're so much, I built you, called you to so much more than that. That's what the father's heart is for you. And so will you leave this place hearing yet another reminder that life is far more than what many of us have made it, and walk out of here ignoring the Holy Spirit's call? Are we going to do that? I hope you're going to be people who actually choose the high calling and step into the fray, into this battle, this life and death battle between the kingdom of darkness and kingdom of light. So what does this look like in our daily lives? I'll just close with this, okay, because this is it. I think in some ways, it either means we're going to be like Scar or Mufasa. Scar, you know, better for worse, the guy was still a member of the royal family. Mufasa said that himself. He's like, what's a little bird was flapping around saying, man, why don't you smoke this fool? He's like, hey, he's my brother. He's still a member of this kingdom. As long as he is, he's here. Wow, that's awesome. There's security even for a jerk like Scar. And guess what? For the many Christians, like here with Scar, he was mean, he was embittered, he was jealous, hateful, vengeful. Man, how many of you know Christians who are like Scar? Totally. Not in this service, usually in the 8 o'clock service though. Wow. But really, you know people like that, you're like, you're a Christian? You? You're like Scar. Well, they'll have to answer to that later. It says at the end, some are going to make it to heaven. It'll be us through fire. They're going to smell like smoke. They're barely making it in, all right? The scars of this world who have no regard for the fact that Christ has given them a new heart and they're still acting like, living like the devil. That's really messed up. And I would say, again, examine yourself. You're going to be that guy? The hateful, vengeful, spiteful, divisive person? Always with the sharp word where people go, you don't really want to talk to her. She's always going to get easily offended. Oh, man, I could preach on that for a minute, but I won't. Or are you going to be more like Mufasa, this righteous king, loving protector of the kingdom that he was, demonstrating in his final act self-sacrifice, laying down his life for another? Our King Jesus is far greater, and his goodness and righteousness far surpass what was displayed in The Lion King in Mufasa. Far greater. And we're supposed to be like our king, our father. It means that we fight against injustice. It means that we battle the sins that try to lay hold of us and ensnare us and keep us in bondage. It means that we care for others to the point of self-sacrifice. It means that we recognize that their freedom from the enemy is a matter of life and death. It means that we use our God-given resources, talents, and all of that to serve the physical and spiritual needs of others. It means that we move, hopefully, out of complacency and engage in this battle that, as I said, is raging all around us for the souls of men and women. Here's the important part that I'll leave you with. Jesus Christ, though he died long ago, he died a long time ago. Even though Jesus died a long time ago, he didn't stay dead. Jesus is alive, and he lives in me, and he lives in you. And that is not some hypothetical theological idea. That is reality for those of us who are of the faith. It's literal. Jesus, the King, he lives in you. Because I live, Jesus said to his disciples, because I live, you also will live. And on that day, you will know that I am in my Father, and you are in me, and I am in you. So do you believe that? If so, are you going to leave this place hearing these words and this challenge to rise up out of complacency, but get offended by the message and leave unchanged and just, yeah, that was really nice. I loved the part where he played the cartoon. That would be so sad. What a sad thing. I don't want to do that because this word challenges me. Who wants to be somebody who hears the truth and then they go out and they don't even do it? I hope that Old Town Church, that you will be one of those who hears these. You're not just a hearer of the word, but you are a doer of it. And because of that, you are a world changing, a world overcomer who's out there on mission, rescuing people who are lost and headed for a life without Christ. And there's kids, and so I'm trying to still keep it Disney. You know what's at stake here. And my hope is that you will be those who are engaged in that battle, rescuing them from the clutches of enemies.